On today's episode, we're going to be doing some resawing. Not just talking about how to do the resawing, let's demonstrate a couple of ways to do it here on the bandsaw.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Sponsored by SawStop, North America's number one cabinet saw. For more information, visit sawstop.com. By Highland Woodworking, fine tools delivered to your door since 1978. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. By Lee Valley and Veritas, with over 5,000 high-quality woodworking hand tools, visit their online catalog at leevalley.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. You know, I've been doing a lot of resawing recently on the last couple of projects. Between the wooden six-pack drink carrier and then the super simple boxes, I've been taking a lot of my thicker material and cutting off thinner pieces from it, trying to utilize as much of that material as possible versus doing what I did years ago, which is simply just run it through the thickness planer and take it from 3/4 down to that 1/4. I mean, imagine going through all of that material just for that really thin stock. Now, I could have easily purchased thinner stock from, say, a home center, or I could have requested it from the mill that I'm purchasing some of my lumber from, and they're more than happy to help you out there. But I've found that sometimes doing such things, especially getting it from the home centers, the material tends to be a little bit more warped and shaped all the wrong ways that I don't want it to. It hasn't been very well seasoned and taken care of to make sure that it's nice and flat. So learning how to resaw has really helped to make a big difference in my project. Now, the first thing when it comes to resawing is make sure that you have the right blade. And in this case, I'm using a wood slicer from Highland Woodworking. And the nice thing about this is the gullets on the teeth are big enough that they're gonna pull the material out of the way. It's not gonna bog down. And you want one that has more or less kind of a rough tooth configuration. So we're talking like 3 TPI, maybe 4. And the most important thing is to have those deep gullets, because it's gonna grab the material and pull it right out of the way as you're cutting it. I made sure that I properly tensioned it. So as you can see in this footage, there is a tension gauge on the back of the saw, and I take it up to approximately where the gauge indicates for a 1/2 inch. Some people will tell you that you don't need that much. In fact, maybe keep it down just a little bit, just under the size that it recommends. But I like to take mine to approximately what the manufacturer is recommending for it. The next thing is we need to make sure that this blade is the table is 90 degrees to the blade. So I'm just gonna take my reliable square here, I'm gonna put it on, and as you can see, we made sure that it is 90 degrees. And I'm not pushing on the blade, I'm holding it on the table and I'm bringing it right up, and I'm looking for daylight in here and I see none. So it is at 90 degrees. And just to be on the safe side, since I'm gonna be using this fence as my guide, I'm gonna be running the stock right up against it, I'm just gonna simply clamp it into place so it's ready to go. It doesn't have to be in any particular place. And I'm gonna check this for 90 degrees, because with this particular fence setup, and with most of them, you can make an adjustment. So I'm gonna check it at a couple of different points, especially near the blade, and for sure, all right, it's all set up. One more thing that we need to think about are the actual guides themselves. Now, I'm not going to tinker with mine too much because I've got them right where I want them. But with most modern day saws, getting these adjusted the right way is really super easy. So please check your manufacturer's recommendations for your bandsaw. Like I said, I don't really want to mess with mine because it will take the show way into a different tangent, and I know somehow I'll end up messing it up. But correcting it really isn't that difficult, so I shouldn't say too much. So please get those at the right depth and the way that they're attached to the blade, or pushing on the blade itself, you'll get really, really good results. All right, so we're getting ready to make our first cut here, and we're just gonna reference our material right up against the fence face here. We're set for about 1/4 inch of a cut on this, and I already went ahead and I have a nice jointed face, I have a nice jointed edge so that they're 90 degrees to each other. And as I had mentioned in the super simple box build, I went ahead and I thickness planed the other side to be dead flat also. And this is gonna really help me out get a really accurate cut from this. So don't force the material through, because in the meantime, you'll make the blade kind of heat up. It'll kind of bend a little bit, potentially break. But more importantly, these gullets are gonna get really clogged up and you won't get a really decent cut from it at all. And you'll even notice it when you take it off, and you'll see how bad the cut is from the areas that you fed through. So as we're making this cut, we'll probably just speed up some of the footage so we can get through it a little bit faster, but we'll see how that works out. So let's make our first cut again with just the fence face, and then we'll put in that single point. So we went ahead and we installed the single point accessory. And one thing I will mention with this is you don't need to compensate for the drift of the fence itself, even though it's attached to the fence, because what will end up happening is it gets its name because it has one single point of contact that you're referencing the material up against while it's being cut. So anyways, let's go ahead and actually get started with this. It doesn't take very long to get a really good cut from this. And again, the same exact thing as what we did previously. Try not to force it through. Just let the blade do the cutting. That piece coming off of the single point, and just like the one that we did against the fence, because we made sure to not rush it through, we got a nice really smooth cut there. It looks really decent. I don't see any barrels right down the center of it, and that is one thing that you will notice if you are pushing through too much as you're finishing that cut. You may notice that the blade will be deflecting a little bit more, and then when you look at the material, especially when you compare it to what you just took off of, you might notice that one has a little bit of a barrel effect to it, or one's a lot thicker in certain areas and thinner in other, and that will definitely tell you if you're pushing it through way too fast. Hopefully that helps you out. If you have comments, questions, suggestions, you know how to get a hold of me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Of course, you can leave a comment in today's show notes at mattsbasementworkshop.com. And if you're watching this over at YouTube, leave a comment over there. I really enjoy hearing from all of you. So until the next episode, I'll be talking to you very soon. Straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. To find even more videos and woodworking related content, be sure to visit our website at mattsbasementworkshop.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Google+. And don't forget to subscribe to the show either on YouTube, in iTunes, or you can even receive email notifications whenever we post something new.